The name of this video is Weak, Strong to Weak Poisson. That is, we will start considering the strong Poisson problem, which is a partial differential equation problem, as we've seen in Phys 242, and eventually we are going to derive from it by integration, as I already mentioned in a previous video, the weak formulation of such a Poisson problem. Therefore, let us consider this is an electric problem, electrostatic problem. Okay, remember that we are considering back-to-back E and B, and we'll consider features of E and features of B. So, just to give an overall concept here, all this, where it's leading to, is to allow us to find a new definition, which is more elegant, more general, of capacitance. Then, as a back-to-back scenario, we're going to consider a very general definition of inductance. So these are the back-to-back EB scenarios we're considering here. Capacitance and inductance much more in depth. All right, so let's consider a raw defined in a region of space, capital omega, which eventually can be extended to the entire universe, as always, capital omega infinite, assuming that raw is zero anywhere outside this capital omega region, as always. See the previous videos. What is the strong formulation of the Poisson problem? It tells us that the scalar Laplacian of the electrostatic potential V has to be equal to minus rho divided by epsilon naught. This is strong Poisson. How do we get the weak formulation? As I already said before, we need to integrate. So let us integrate to find the weak formulation. So we are going to bring this rho over epsilon naught with a minus on the left-hand side, so it becomes plus equal to zero. In addition, we will multiply times a function of r phi, which is a trial function. We will need this in order to perform minimizations. So this is our trial function. So remember that var phi has a similar structure as capital V, so the electrostatic potential, even though technically var phi is different than generally is different than capital V, but it retains some of its properties. For example, if V goes to zero as 1 over r at infinite, also var phi will go to zero as 1 over r. By doing so and performing this integration now, which is the weak formulation, so the integral smoothens things, and so we end up having the volume integral in the region capital omega extended to infinite of the scalar Laplacian of V times the trial function bar phi integrated over dr cube, the volume element. We bring this to the other side, so it becomes plus 1 over epsilon naught. We are integrating over the same region capital omega infinite. We are integrating rho times the trial function phi, and again, this is integrated over dr cube. Great, so this is the weak formulation of the Poisson problem, which means we integrated it. Note that this strong and weak formulation, in particular the weak formulation, is critical, for example, in FEM, finite element methods, which is all based on Sobolev spaces, which all comes from this weak formulation. So it's not just a generic mathematical construction, it's super important in numerical calculations. And that's by no chance, because basically the FEM, the finite element method, is a kind of a minimization problem of a weak problem, a problem written in weak form. And what we are trying to do eventually to find the capacitance by means of a weak problem is also something which you could do numerically. So our approach for capacitance, it's like a back of the envelope approach, FEM, if you want. Okay, so it's quite interesting, and I think you will find it amazing when we get there. And note that it can be applied to anything else. So not only to the Poisson equation for charge distributions. This could be the equation of a membrane, like a drum, which is acted upon a force F instead of rho. So in that case, B becomes U, the displacement of the drum, and rho becomes the force which makes it vibrate. And so this is important, for example, to study phonons. And so it's a very important concept, obviously, used in many other cases in physics, not only electrostatics. All right. So now that we know this, we need to remind ourselves what is the first green identity. which we already encountered, we encountered some green identities in 242. So let me remind you what is the first green identity. We use them in the case of electrostatic shields, when we solve that mathematically, formally. So in this case, imagine that the volume integral on a region capital omega extended to infinite of the var phi. So let's keep var phi on the other side, like we've done here. So the scalar Laplacian of V times var phi, so it's exactly what we have up here, integrated over dr cube. This quantity plus the volume integral on capital omega infinite of the gradient of capital V times the gradient of var phi integrated over dr cube. This quantity has to be equal to the surface integral closed on capital sigma infinite, which is the boundary of capital omega infinite, of var phi gradient of capital V dr square, the area element. Again, I remind you that we use this in the case of electrostatic shields. And a similar concept I'm about to use here, we also used it to find the electrostatic energy UE, defined in this in the fashion I've seen in the previous video, 1 over epsilon naught integral of E square. We used also what I'm about to do here now. In fact, this quantity here, this area, the surface capital sigma infinite, can be considered, since it's infinitely, it's at infinite distance, it can be, by definition, just a circle with radius r going to plus infinite. Now, as I already said before, var phi retains the properties of B, which means var phi goes to infinite as 1 over r. What about the gradient of V? The gradient of capital V is actually nothing but minus E. Okay, so E is minus the gradient of V. So this one, from Coulomb's law, at infinite, a very large distance, goes asymptotically as 1 over r squared. What about the area associated with capital sigma infinite? Well, this one goes asymptotically for large values as r squared, pi r squared. So if we consider this integral on the surface, we have phi, so this integral goes as the integral on our surface, capital sigma infinite, of something which goes as 1 over r for var phi, 1 over r squared for the gradient of B, which is E, times r squared. So this cancels out. And when I go in the limit r that goes to plus infinite, this whole quantity cancels out to 0 because it eventually goes as 1 over r and it goes to 0 at infinite. So here we are completely exactly on this infinite surface. So this result is 0, which means this integral is equal to minus this integral, okay? Because the result is equal to 0. Now, if we use this information, so now we can rewrite this quantity here, which is this quantity here. So this is nothing but that. This is equal to minus this quantity. So we can take the minus of this, bring it here, change the signs and multiply time epsilon naught. And so I bring the epsilon naught here on the left-hand side. This, which is a minus, I change sign, becomes plus, integral over omega infinite. This Laplacian becomes actually the gradient of capital B times dotted with the gradient of bar phi, dr cube. And this is dotted here, dot product. So this is minus, but I change sign is plus. And so this becomes minus, and epsilon naught I already brought it to the other side. So it's minus the integral on omega infinite extended of rho bar phi dr cube. So this quantity here, of course, what I forgot to write here is that this has to be equal to 0, right? because I brought this on the left-hand side, so it is equal to zero, and I integrated. So the weak formulation is this equal to zero, which is equivalent to that after integration. So remember that this has to be equal to zero. And again, let me remind you that since the result of this surface integral is zero because of this asymptotic behavior, this becomes minus this, but this is this, then I change the sign and multiply time epsilon naught, and that's what you get. So this is the final result that we get, which is pivotal for what we are about to show in the next video, which is about minimization. So you will need to remember this for the next video about minimization, which is where I'm trying to give you part of the story, at least part of the proof of what I said in the previous video, which was that among all possible function v, the one v bar, which minimizes the minus ue functional of v, is the solution to the electrostatic problem. We need this in order to prove at least part of the story. In the notes, I proved the whole thing. In the video, we'll only prove half of the story. So it's an if and only if condition, so I will only prove one part and not the other. I will let you try the other side, the other part. In particular, it is worth rewriting this equation in 1D, because in the next video, that's what we're going to do to simplify notation in one dimension. This equation in one dimension becomes epsilon naught line integral on some region lambda, which I just call lambda instead of lambda infinite. The gradient of B becomes simply V prime. The gradient over phi becomes phi prime. This becomes dx minus the integral on lambda of rho times var phi dx equal zero. And this is the equation we're going to use in the next video just because it's simpler in terms of notation. So to summarize this video, what we've done here is we went from the strong formulation of the Poisson problem, which is the scalar Laplacian of V equal minus rho over epsilon naught for a given rho, to the weak, which means we integrate it. In addition, we also multiply times over phi. Why do I need to do that? Okay, let me give you a caveat here just to be precise. This is a weak formulation, but also with a multiplication times var phi. Why do I need that? Because I want to use some functional minimization in the next video to show you that this is all consistent with the previous video. Okay, so this is a little bit, I notice now, it's a little bit an abuse of language because I'm actually multiplying times var phi. So it's a little bit more complicated than just the weak formulation of the Poisson problem. I'm just abusing the language a little bit. The weak formulation is really the one we've seen in the previous video, which is eventually we are going to refine in the minimization. So this is actually, all this video is a step in between to show that what I told in the video, the weak formulation of the electrostatic problem is actually correct, okay? So keep in mind that. Here we are multiplying times this var phi. So we do that, so this is an intermediate step to the proof, if you want. So then we use the first screen identity using the same kind of asymptotic behavior as we've seen one time in 242. And this allows us to find this equation, which is very useful for minimization purposes. That's it.